Spring, right? Spring?
Formally it's spring, but I'm not really sure that I can call it spring. But we are hopeful, as we were saying with Radityo, that by next week we might even touch 20 degrees. That would be a miracle, but let's see.
It's very humid in Surabaya.
Uh-huh.
But
okay.
All over my body. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I believe. We fast for 13 hours. Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Okay, the live streaming has been started, so please let me to open our discussion today. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, welcome to Cakra Studies Global Strategies and Johan Schaik Institute for Political Studies joint lecture series. This lecture series is actually a part of our joint dissemination series that concludes our cooperation between the two institutions to talk and discuss about some contemporary international relations and other political issues. And today in our third series, we are going to have two amazing speakers in our theme entitled European Union and ASEAN Diverging Road of International Regional Cooperation. First of all, let me introduce myself. My name is Demas Novarian. I am currently a research staff at Cakra Studi Global Strategies. Cakra Studi Global Strategies is a global and strategic studies think tank under Department of International Relations, Universitas Erlangga. And for the past few months, we already held cooperation with Johan Schut Institute for Political Studies. And we are very glad to have two speakers with us today in our virtual Zoom meeting room. In today's agenda, we are going, our theme is European Union and ASEAN Diverging Road of Regional Integration. And we already have two outstanding speakers that are experts in both area of expertise, and we are very glad to have them. So first of all, I would like to extend my welcome to Stefano Baragiroli. He is an associate professor in Johan Schut Institute for Political Studies, University of Tartu, Estonia. Good afternoon, good morning, Stefano.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Or actually, good afternoon, I should say, because there it's afternoon, as far as I understand.
Oh, yeah. So, how are you doing? Are you doing fine?
All good, all good. Apart, as I was saying before, a not particularly enjoyable weather, but everything is good.
Thank you very much, Stefano, for joining in with us today. And second of all, we have Citra Henida. She is an assistant professor at Department of International Relations, Universitas Erlangga, Indonesia. And she is also the convener of the Regional International Relations in our department. So good afternoon, Mbak Citra.
Good afternoon, Demas.
Good. How are you? Are you? We heard that you are having a little medical issues.
Yes, a little bit of sore throat because I drink a lot of beverages, sugary beverages, so it's not good for my neck.
Just like most of Indonesians,
yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. It's a very typical custom, reminding that we in Indonesia currently are having our fasting month, and it is currently at 3 p.m. in Indonesia, so we are having another 2 p.m. before we break our fast. So, okay, in today's session, we are very lucky to have these two experts in regional studies, and what our aim about today's discussion is that the cooperation between Universitas Erlangga and University of Tartu is a cross-regional cooperation. And we, as international relations scholars, we really would like to understand more about each other's form of regional organization and regionalism in general. And therefore, in the main objective of our session today is actually not merely about understanding or knowing about AU or ASEAN per se as about their profile or etc., but we really would like to know about what actually differ them as regional organizations, and how does then the difference in each regional organization would impact the dynamics in each region. So our session today would actually be divided into a few small sections. After our speakers will give an introduction about both European Union, Stefano would convey, and ASEAN, Mbak Citra would convey. We will talk a little bit about the first section. We'll talk about the driver of each regional integration. What are actually the main factor that make regionalism exist in the very first place? And then in the second section, we will try to talk about the challenges, about what are actually the hurdles that make the regional integration as they are today. And in the third, we will try to compare that uniquely, both European Union and ASEAN actually have some similar challenges in the past. We have similar challenges about economy, we have challenges about some other great powers in the region and etc. So we will try to see about how the different nature of both organization will then convey to different response. And in the end, of course, we will try to conclude about what do we learn actually from all of our talks today. And of course, we will try to make our session today as interactive as possible. So after our a little guided discussion in the beginning, we will try to get some questions from the audience. We believe that we already have about 50 participants in this Zoom room. So a little note for all the participants, should you have any question, kindly just type it in the chat box and we will try to convey your questions to Stefano and Bacitra. Okay, so if you would excuse me, I will like to start our the introduction for our session today. So European Union and ASEAN has been considered as a regional organization that are very different, but yet both of them has been considered by some academics to be as successful in their own ways. Both of them are a representative of what some people consider as old and new regionalism, and what other have considered to be a successful regional integration in different parts of the world. So first of all, I would like to ask about Stefano, because most of us in not only in Erlangga, also in Indonesia in general, are still sort of seeing that European Union is a very far away and a very different entity from what we have, for example, in ASEAN. So to introduce us a little bit to European Union, how can you give us a little traction or example about what the European Union actually is?
Okay, well, of course, for that, I might need, let's say, 3 days. So I will try to maybe pick something that I believe is the main engine behind the process of integration at the EU level. And I would even say that one thing that we might explore further during our discussion is really this divergence, which I think is at the core of the comparison, for example, between ASEAN and the EU, between regional integration and regional cooperation. So what we see at the EU level is very much a regional integration, which basically means that the very initial secret of European integration was to take increasingly large slices of sovereignty from the member state and shifting them at a higher level. So basically, the member states decide to renounce, for the time being, of course, to some portions of their sovereignty and pool it with other member states, with the idea that certain goals of common concern can be better achieved together. And in a way, sharing sovereignty is the price that you are willing to pay in order to achieve that common goal. And if I need to look briefly at this common goal, and you know what has been probably the most exemplary outcome of the project of integration in the European context, well, I would definitely say the single market. Well, in fact, as we know, of course, at the end of World War II, winners and losers had one goal: to reconstruct their economies. And that basically became the very much like driving force behind integration. And I would say that the single market, which has started officially as an attempt in the mid-50s, and is basically the goal, the totem that has justified integration in so many fields of policies, from transport to customer protection, to environmental protection, to the euro itself. I mean, all these policies were connected to the idea that to have a really integrating and functioning single market, you need to share certain features. So for example, let's say, if in one country, the trade unions are extremely weak, and in another, there is a very high labor protection, well, of course, the cost of labor is very different, which means that you need to have a uniform, let's say, labor policy. The same applies, for example, to production standards. When I produce chocolate in my country and I export it to another country, we need to have common standards in order to have that product recognized as, let's say, acceptable to the other market. So all that descended out of the single market, transport policy, postal policies, again, the euro, the structural funds, all the policy areas that the European integration got until, in fact, at least the early 90s, are all derived by one idea, the single market. So I think that this is a good, let's say, antipasto to start with.
Thank you very much, Stefano, for your insight about what are actually like becoming the drivers in the regional integration and sort of shape about the nature of European Union itself. So it is definitely something that we studied a lot in international relations, but also something that maybe empirically as Indonesians specifically, we don't see a lot in the level of ASEAN. So therefore, I would like to continue the discussion with Mbak Ceha. Mbak Ceha, so what are actually how would you best describe ASEAN, and how would you actually say that what are the main drivers of regional integration in ASEAN itself?
Thank you, Demas. First of all, thank you for having me here today. And ASEAN is a little bit different with the European Union because the European after the war, World War, they need to rebuild, to reconstruct their economy. But ASEAN is a little bit different. They are a new nation, new state. So their motivational for regional cooperation, first of all, is nationalism. Nationalism, geopolitical situation during the Cold War, and of course to construct their economy as a new state. There are also several proposals from Southeast ASEAN. Proposal from Vietnam, Myanmar, and Thailand. They want to make sure that they use regional cooperation to fasten their independence. For the Vietnam, for the Myanmar, and how to attract the UK, the France to fasten their independence. So, because they are too weak to act by itself, so they need regional cooperation, bands of state to sit together and then talk about the independence. And there are also domestic situation that make the nationalism put together is very difficult that time, because they actually two opposite groups. First is nationalist revolutionary. Usually they oppose Western, and the other one is moderate nationalist. Usually they oppose China and the communists. So between Vietnam proposal, Myanmar proposal, Thailand proposal, and the latest is Indonesian proposal, they want to think at the national level and project their problem into regional level. And then they want their occupied state question their nationalism, and they having the spirit of decolonization. So different with the Europe, when they take up their national identity, their state left behind, and something like that. But Southeast Asian state is different. Decolonization projected into regional cooperation that acknowledge their national sovereignty. They put sovereignty at the very first priority. So for the regional cooperation, that we have to put back our national identity, national selfishness, is not happen in ASEAN and other decolonization, the new state in Asia or in Africa. So this is a burden for the ASEAN now, and it said in the ASEAN way, they said that a nationality, our national sovereignty put at the first. And there's also a norm in Asian way, we call it Asian way, like no interference and something like that. At the global governance and global cooperation, it's very difficult to put something like that. And the second driver is also, is of course geopolitical situation during the Cold War. There is a ideological polarization between the way, between the democratic, liberal democratic, and communism. And the situation influence ideological polarization at the national level. Indonesia has had experienced communist rebellion. And in Indochina, other ASEAN member is also afraid that they would fail into communism. Also domino theory at the US. And they also afraid about the collective security and influence of its development, whether they go with the Unisoviet or go with United States. And the last one is, as a new state, they consider about how to construct their economy. So they need a peaceful region to attract more investment. During that time, it's not investment, but aid, and aid from the US, of course, or the Unisoviet. So in conclusion, what the main driver of regional integration in Southeast Asia, I would call that first is nationalism and decolonization. They use regional cooperation to fasten the nationalism and to acknowledge the Trinity as a new state. And the second one, geopolitical situation during the Cold War. And the last one, economic development. That's all, Demas. Demas?
Okay, thank you very much, Mbak Citra, for the 3 points that you summarized as the main drivers in regional integration. So to summarize, it is even like from the very beginning, from the origin of both regions, we can see that there is a different, not only context, but also ideas that drive the existence of both regionalism. Meanwhile, the EU exists as a way for European states to rebuild their post-war economy and also to advance their economy. The ASEAN exists as such a political tool of Southeast Asian states in order to protect themselves not only from further colonization and to execute decolonization, but also then to protect themselves from the intense geopolitical competition, especially during the Cold War. So then my question is that while the two have a very different origin and the idea that drives them is different, but then in a way, currently both regional integration, both organizations are conducting similar cooperations between the states, in the sense that both of them try to advance economic development. Both of them are actually trying to protect the interests of their member states. So my question is that, first of all, to Stefano, I think, do you think that the same driver that create the European Union during its early years are actually still relevant up to today? Or is there any either shift or broadening of the driver of regional integration in the case of EU?
Again, thanks a lot for the question. And I mean, I will address it. I just want to touch one point which connects to what Citra mentioned, because I very much agree with what you mentioned. So in a sense that the very drivers behind the two projects were fairly diverse. I mean, especially in a post-colonial context, the idea of nation to reaffirm itself is fundamental. And what we see in the European integration process at the very beginning is a complete rejection of nationalism. So in a way, nationalism is very much identified as the cause behind the start of World War II. So in fact, what, let's say, the pioneers of European integration want to say is like, okay, let's not have unleashed completely uncontrolled member states. And the best way to prevent war, because of course, again, one thing is, again, to have working economies. Another thing is, of course, let's say, to grant peace. The best way to grant peace is to take sovereignty a bit away from the member states, because otherwise they can, let's say, take the wrong route. That's it. And in a way, this is very much acknowledging the, let's say, the immaturity of the member states. I mean, the immaturity of the nation state. The nation state, which has been basically the main protagonist of European history in the last 300 years, at least, is basically the immature actor that has determined the collapse of Europe, first in World War I and then in World War II. And then out of that, what do you see in the EU, and you don't see so much in other projects for regional integration, like in ASEAN, is the emergence of a strong supranational center. So in a way, what you see at the EU level today is a strong European Commission, which is basically the executive of the EU, which is basically the government of the EU, while what you see in many other projects of regional cooperation around the world, and in that sense, ASEAN is reflecting this type of model, is more a secretariat that serves basically the interest of the member states. So it's not much about sovereignty shared, it's very much about protecting the national sovereignty, as Citra just said. And in fact, the last thing that I mentioned about this is, what we see is also that if we have a strong supranational above the state center, I would even say something pseudo-federal, then you can also have a parliamentary dimension. That's why starting from the 70s, the European Parliament becomes directly elected by the citizens, because of course, Brussels plays a big role. Now, the question is, are these driving forces still relevant nowadays? Well, I mean, let's say, of course, having successful economies is still a driving force today. That I can very much subscribe. The question is, to what extent citizens perceive the single market as a working success, and most of all, they are able to grasp the benefits of the market. Because I would say, after 30 years of having a pretty much finalized single market, Europeans take pretty much for granted that they can, for example, I don't know, take goods from pretty much all over the Union, travel all over the Union, and I go to work to another country, enjoy exactly the same benefits of that country. And the problem with taking things for granted is that you don't really value them that much. And as we saw, for example, with the case of Brexit, when then you try to kind of, you know, put the clock back, then you get quite a cold shower, realizing that, you know, things that you took for granted are not there anymore. And in a way, this is really a key fundamental problem, which I believe relates to the, let's say, not great capacity of the EU institutions and member states to communicate the exceptionality of these, let's say, benefits to the citizens and keep somehow the relevance of these alive. And of course, there is another factor, and then I will not monopolize the discussion for too long, but the other factor is peace. I mean, you know, the point is that, luckily, for Europeans that live inside the EU, because of course there is a Europe beyond the EU, but let's say for Europeans who live inside the EU, the concept of war is something that you see on TV, is something that doesn't happen in Europe, is something that happens far away, maybe somewhere in the exotic borders of Europe. But again, no one imagines nowadays a war in the European Union. So the problem is that the generation of my granddad experienced the war and they knew what they were running away from. The teenagers of today, they have no idea of what war is. So for them saying, look, European Union grants peace, is like saying, okay, cool, so anything else? And this is really a risk because when you're not aware of the risks and you take things for granted, and then you are kind of, you know, saying, okay, I take this for granted, but I really don't like many other things. So I vote for nationalist, for, you know, radical parties that ask for this, expecting that you don't lose what you like, but you can basically get rid of what you don't like. Well, in a way, it's a quite, you know, risky game sometimes.
Okay, thank you for that. We can clearly see about on how then the European Union has become something that not only benefit as, you know, a political tool, actually like an instrument in the upper level, but also it has touched the life of so many European in its heart, in its core. And we can see that how much that it actually become a very deep regional integration model. And so I want to throw this back to Mbak Citra. So Mbak Citra, how would you then try to compare the ASEAN and maybe, I don't know whether, how would you actually describe or maybe protect the ideas of ASEAN as a regional integration in comparison to EU?
Okay, it's quite different with the Europe, what happened in Southeast Asia. Because I call it as inherent contradiction. ASEAN has its inherent contradiction because they put nationalist nation state at the first level. So it influences how they behave and how the youngest and how the citizen of each Southeast Asian nation feel about the ASEAN. For example, in Indonesia, we don't see us as ASEAN people, even though in 2008, we call it ASEAN community. If you ask a student at the elementary or the junior high, if they're not interested like student in international relation, they have a lack of knowledge on ASEAN. Put nation state at level, it makes ASEAN structure, ASEAN meetings, it's only involves and it's not people. Even though from 2008, ASEAN claimed that they want to imitate EU and see ASEAN as community, but we don't feel it. And ASEAN good on papers, but not on execution. So they call it an executive club. At the first beginning, ASEAN is only the meeting of the leaders. And then at the ministry level, first I will explain about the ASEAN states of development. At the first 10 years, 1967 until 1976, they focus on establishment, on solidarity, and treat them as dialogue partners. So it's pure on cooperation. It's not integration. And the next 20 years, 1977 until 1997, the Asian financial crisis. Before the Asian financial crisis, they focus on economic development. So how they make Southeast ASEAN is a fast market. So they focus on the expansion. First from the Brunei in 1984, and then Vietnam, 1995, Laos, Myanmar in 1997, and the last one is Cambodia in 1999. How to integrate all the Southeast Asian nation at the north part? And they think that even though Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia, so some hostile hostile behavior, but ASEAN thinks, especially Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, and Thailand, thinks that they have more geo-economical benefit if they join into ASEAN. It's different. While some ASEAN nation like Singapore, Laos, and Myanmar postpone Timor-Leste membership, the situation is different because they see that if we not attract Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia, so they will be under the influence of the great power. So it's against the idea of national itself, self-reliance itself. So they okay and put Vietnam, Laos, Myanmar, and Cambodia into ASEAN. The next 10 years after Asian financial crisis, 1998 until 2007, before ASEAN charter, they built the ways into formalization. Before, ASEAN is like a executive club, more informal, more dialogue partner, something like that. But after the ASEAN financial crisis, they realized that we have a very small market and we go to the same market for our products. And our product is not a complementary, but it's substitute. We produce the same products and we sell into the same market. So when the crisis hits Southeast Asian, they realize that we need another partner. And to attract another partner, we need to formalize our cooperation. That's why ASEAN Charter is formed, and the next 7 years, 2008 until 2015, when they said that ASEAN Economic Cooperation started in 2015, so they focus on the community building. And that's why I conclude that the main driver is still relevant, especially their nationalism, what I call an inherent contradiction. They put nation state at the first level, and then they still consider geopolitical situation, but it's different after the Cold War. And it's different because they have to face a rising China and then multilateralism and something like that. And then they still make economic as the major driver in ASEAN. Why I said that economic as the major driver in integration in ASEAN, before the crisis in 1997, ASEAN integration is driven by MNC and multinational cooperation and foreign direct investment, especially from Japan, and also drive by Chinese overseas who have a net business network in Indonesia, in Malaysia, in Singapore, in Hong Kong, and something like that. That make that put Southeast Asian nation cooperate and integrate. But there's no sense of identity belonging into the ASEAN, but it's pure on the business. So after the crisis, they see that they need to formalize the relation with its partner. That's why there is ASEAN plus 3, ASEAN plus 7, ASEAN plus 10, ASEAN plus 15, and then they go into the community building. That's all, Demas.
Okay, thank you, Mbak Citra. I have actually one follow-up question. So earlier, Stefano explained about how in the European Union, the integration actually touched to the core and the society itself. And you mentioned that post-1997, there is this sort of sense of community building that ASEAN tries to build in the region. Do you think that our sense of belonging and the ASEAN succeed to actually build that regional community sense of belonging? Or do you think that it actually is something that further differ us from the Europeans?
Stefano or me?
You, Mbak Citra. Oh, I was asking in the case of ASEAN.
Okay, after the ASEAN Charter, let me explain about the ASEAN Charter first. There's a lot of structure. ASEAN Charter changes how we think about ASEAN. There's a lot of ASEAN Charter build ASEAN community. There's a political community, economic community, and social cultural community. So at the political level, there's a lot of dialogue, and there's a lot of institution under the ASEAN Charter. And it also involve community as a whole. For example, like at the social cultural community, you involve like universities and civilian organization, something like that, to engage ASEAN people. But the idea is how to make ASEAN is no longer executive club, but people of ASEAN can feel ASEAN itself and give benefit to them. But sovereignty, non-intervention, is like a major obstacle how they resolve their conflict. For example, under the ASEAN Charter, the new one is human rights protection. But ASEAN has different definition about the human right itself. Human right in Asian people based on community right is not individual right. It's different with the Western version of human right. So they cannot use them. They cannot use a human right commission to solve their human rights violation problem. For example, migrant worker, and then labor, and then Rohingya, something like that, because they not agree about the human right protection itself, and they put state as the main actor to formalize the declaration. The commission, they not involve the NGO and then civil society organization to how to formalize human rights commission on the ASEAN level. That's why problem with human rights, like what we see in Rohingya, like what we see in South Thailand, South Philippines, in Indonesia, is not solved yet. That's a problem. And then the other thing, ASEAN Charter is also acknowledged about the protection of women, migrant worker. But what we see in Malaysia and Singapore, the violation is still there, because they see that migrant worker as a criminal offense instead of they are actually the victim of trafficking. Different view on the migrant worker has caused the problem still exists in Malaysia, in Singapore, Malaysia and Singapore. And during the COVID-19, at Singapore, the spread of the COVID-19, the highest level is at the migrant worker settlement, because Singapore government doesn't acknowledge them as a citizen on the quote. That's why they don't have enough protection and have no access into health system. This is a small example how actually ASEAN is good on paper. It's good on the institutional. There's a lot of institutional. And there are 14 event and forum at the government level, at the community level to engage with ASEAN. For example, there are a meeting through ASEAN Secretariat, ASEAN Community Forum, ASEAN Social Forum, ASEAN Government-led event, ASEAN Sectoral Minister, ASEAN Working Group, ASEAN Community Council, ASEAN National Secretariat, Komite Permanen Representative, and ASEAN Civil Society Forum, ASEAN Accredited NGO, ASEAN Intergovernmental Commission on Human Rights, Women and Children, Migrant Worker, ASEAN Foundation, and Media Discussion. There's a lot of event and forum, but yet the problem is not settled, because they put the government and the nation state at the first level. That's why inherent contradiction itself in the ASEAN. And even though they formalize the ASEAN as organization, but the spirit is still informal. And they make a lot of forum, event, structures. They are criticized that is how the government wash their hand, as if they protect the human right, they protect the migrant worker, by having declaration committee and something like that. But the idea of the government put at the first level, it's actually put the ASEAN far from the people itself.
Okay.
Especially at the strategic issue. But they work in more, it's not strategic. For example, at the COVID-19, ASEAN, under the social and cultural, they have a health commission. They only share information and communication. but they still put national as the first level. So okay. It's only information and communication, but not at the budget and how to make supply chains on the medicine, on masker or something like that is more easier.
Okay.
It doesn't happen.
Okay, thank you very much, Mbak Citra. Mbak Citra definitely enlightened us about how the concept of inherent contradiction therefore actually prevent ASEAN from actually implementing its vision on creating a community-based approach and therefore beginning to only work better on paper, but rather redundant on a few other strategic sectors. So maybe a little bit, I would like to like try to bridge about how this then become one of the challenges, especially in both regional integration. So Stefano, do you think that in a way then, by being a supranational entity, AU then able to navigate these problems different with ASEAN, especially are they able to like create this really European, united European community?
Well, I think that this is very much the issue that nowadays many Europeans are asking themselves, and not only Europeans, but even the leaderships, in fact, both national and EU at EU level. Well, one thing that I would like to mention that somehow is a kind of starting point to address this question is that we need to look at how basically a member state joins the EU, because that's very much something which I believe relates to the understanding of how this EU multi-layered cake works. Citra was mentioning again, why specific Southeast Asian countries decided to join ASEAN and what was the overall rationale behind. Now, of course, when aspiring member states decide to embark in a project of regional cooperation or integration, of course, they have interest, national interest they would like to project there. And of course, that applies in every context. I mean, I'm here in Estonia. Estonia joined for a few reasons. One, of course, was economy. The other one was geopolitics, and so on and so forth. But what is interesting is that I give you the case of Estonia. Estonia, in fact, was a very successful applicant. But Estonia expressed its interest and formal application to join the EU in 1995. And negotiated basically for 9 years and joined the EU in 2004. So this means that the very idea is that the day you join the EU, your way of organizing public life, way of organizing political life, way of taking decision, policies and so on are completely changed. So the very paradigm is that in order to join the EU, you need basically to close 35 chapters addressing pretty much every aspect of your life, from foreign policy to economy, from statistics to welfare state, from external trade to education. So the moment in which you join, exactly because the EU has such a pervasive scope of policies, you should have a very high degree of compatibility with the countries that are already part of the EU in order not to create disruptions. So that is a key fundamental idea, exactly because the EU does so much. And now the question is, relates to the challenges and to your question. So an EU, which is an example of regional integration, is able to, let's say, effectively address challenges that it faces, exactly in the light of this supranational, let's say, structure that it has. And again, here we can look at what we are experiencing exactly nowadays, COVID, for example. You know, we didn't mention it yet, so it was you know, time to bring it out of the hat. Or again, for example, financial crisis, or for example, again, geopolitical challenges. I mean, I'm here in Estonia, we cross the border river called Narva River, and then in fact, we have Russia here. So how well does the EU address these challenges? And here I would say that some of the challenges are addressed quite effectively. So when we talk, for example, about economy, the EU has all the tools that it needs. I would say something which is fairly federal in terms of, let's say, tools of management to address this quite effectively. So let's say where the EU has very strong power vis-a-vis the member states, then you can expect a relatively effective and efficient answer from the supranational level. Because basically, the powers have been shifted from the member states to the European Commission, or in any case, to the supranational core of the EU. When we deal with policy areas in which the member states still have a quite strong voice vis-a-vis the supranational center, take, for example, foreign affairs. That is where the EU is more a pygmy than a giant. There was a very famous say by a former Belgian prime minister who said, like, the EU is a giant in trade, a dwarf in foreign policy, and a worm in security. So the point is that, and this is exactly because of this, when it comes to external trade, when it comes again to trade policy, single market, and so on and so forth, the EU is the power because the member states are completely disempowered. The member state can say very little. But when we talk about foreign policy, there is a structure of the EU to deal with foreign policy. We have a high representative for common foreign and security policy. We have the council dealing with that. We have European External Action Service, which basically is the EU Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and so on and so forth. But the point is that all decisions are taken by unanimity. The member states are basically the ones that basically set the direction of the policies. And that is when, for example, you see that when dealing with Russia, just mentioning one, but I could say, for example, China, or let's say US, when the situation of transatlantic relation is not great, so for example, Trump administration, we see that the attitude of these third actors is to play with the individual member states rather than with Brussels. Because if you deal with individual member states, you can play an easy game of divide and rule. If you play with Brussels, first of all, you need to understand the rules of playing with Brussels, which is not always easy to get. But also, you need basically to, you have much more difficulty because, again, if the member states are united and represented by the EU, then, of course, their, let's say, cumulative power is much bigger. So clearly, for external actors like Russia, China, and so on and so forth, it's easier to play with individual member states and, for example, to single out other members. When it comes, for example, again, to COVID, just that's another challenge that we are facing at the moment. What we have seen is like two phases. In the first phase, this is clearly an unprecedented challenge. I mean, of course, scientists, medical experts were telling us for decades that this would have come, but of course, who paid attention? So the point is that when the pandemic came, of course, no one was prepared for that. And what we have seen at the beginning is that, again, the contradiction once again comes to light. So the member states, in a moment of crisis and shock, start to basically move very, let's say, chaotically. Each of them tries to respond, nationally without much of EU coordination, also because, in fact, the EU didn't have many powers at the time in terms of health and in terms of civil protection with respect to health of citizens. So we have seen a very chaotic answer. But then very fast, in a couple of months, the member states realize that, look, yes, you can try to do something. But for example, you don't have any more very effective national medicine agencies. When it comes again to regulation and so on, all of that have been devolved to the EU level. Also, if you start, let's say, playing with vaccine, health, trade nationalism, nothing works because European states are so interdependent that the moment in which you start basically closing borders, locking down things and so on, things really don't work. Moreover, for example, if you need to order, even before the vaccines, if you need to order, for example, protective gears, respirators, and so on, that are produced outside of the EU, each member state, even the big ones of the EU, Germany, France, Italy, vis-a-vis China, US, or India, are basically little actors. So that's why very fast the member states realized that the only way to tackle effectively the crisis was to act at the EU level. They came up with the recovery fund. The recovery fund, in fact, is the most ambitious, I would say, almost comparable to Roosevelt New Deal, in a sense like the most effective economic proactive action taken at the EU level since, in fact, the Marshall Plan. And this mobilizes huge amount of money. And for the first time, the EU has been able to go to the markets, collect that money as part of basically launching some sort of EU bonds, something that generally the member states would do, but this time the EU does, and manage those funds, this rescue fund and this security funds. When it comes to the vaccines, well, let's say, of course, if we look at the map of vaccination rates in Europe and US, well, the EU is doing okay, but really not fantastic, let's say. And I would say here is the curse and the advantage of having done things together. So the EU is a block of 27 member states in which you have countries with very different capacities. You have like Germany and France that, again, they could have easily gone to the market, buy, I don't know, Pfizer, Moderna, and so on for three times the price. Basically, that's why, I don't know, Israel, Singapore, US are doing so well, or UK, because in fact, they paid quite a lot, and they paid fast. The EU had two limits. The first one is that, you know, in order to take decisions, which were kind of acceptable to all the 27 member states, there was a lot of negotiation. And the other thing was, of course, that, you know, the amount of money in percentage, of course, that a country like Germany, France, or Italy are willing to put on the table for the bid, for example, to get vaccines, is incomparably bigger than the one that countries like Bulgaria or Romania are willing to put on the table. So what basically they had to do was like, you know, a very tiring and long negotiation to keep the bloc together. And when finally, again, the agreements were found among the member states, other countries arrived first. So US and UK were there much earlier than the EU, exactly because of this complicated decision-making machine. So another lesson that we can learn out of this is that the EU is really good at deciding things when, again, the environment is predictable, when we play by the rules, and when somehow there is a very well-regulated context. When there is, let's say, something unpredictable, partners that do not play by the same rules, and the chaotic environment, the EU with the current decision-making rules is not that effective, exactly because there is still this hybridity between the member states and the supranational center.
Okay, thank you very much, Stefano. That is a very interesting point about how then the European Union is actually as supranational or integrated as it is, but they still have a sort of a diverging, and there are still nations that try to break out of it or behave differently in that case. So I think I want to have one follow-up question to you, Stefano. Then, in this specifically, in this time of crisis, because we see that most of this diverging behaviors exist in times of crisis, how then the European Union as an institution basically tries to keep it all together? Does it like really is only based on the power of the willingness of the space, or does it actually as an institution have a power to sort of like get a conflict management when there is this things?
Yeah, I think that the question is very relevant. And by the way, I mean, of course, we have a number of evidences of this fatigue that we are facing. I mean, of course, the most tangible one is Brexit. I mean, let's say some very pro-Europeans would tell you, well, yes, of course, Brexit wasn't the great news, but since the UK, since the moment it joined, started basically to kind of, you know, erode the process of integration, now without the UK, we can fly high and shine. Now, I have, let's say, conflicting feelings about that. It's true that the UK somehow has never been an easy partner, but it's also true that clearly Brexit signals that there is a problem with the project of integration. And moreover, it's not only Brexit. I mean, if you look at countries like Poland and Hungary, you know, clearly there is a mismatch in terms of expectations and behavior of these countries inside the EU. We see, let's say, a growing wave of illiberalism at the EU level. We see that somehow, for example, countries like Poland and Hungary make full use of the resources of the EU in terms of economic growth, in terms of development and so on, but do not seem to fully accept the values behind the process of integration. And there is no way in which we can force a Blexit or Whoexit. So these countries will be there, and in a way, if not, if we don't cope with these challenges, well, this country would keep bringing disruption inside the way the EU works. And to your question, is there a way in which the EU is trying to engage with these issues? The simple answer is yes. Very much nowadays, today, in these days, in fact, we have an ongoing conference on the future of Europe, which has been launched by the three institutions, European Commission, European Parliament, and European Council. And the idea is to have very much a citizen-wide consultation and ongoing discussion among institutions, national and supranational, on how to tackle these challenges. So the idea is like really to get input from citizens, NGOs, political parties, intellectuals, academics, pretty much everyone, and to kind of, you know, discuss these ideas at the EU level. Now, of course, the question is, as a famous French politician said, if you want to basically to ignore a problem, create a commission, keep discussing it ad infinitum, and then in the end, let's say, you will never solve the problem. So, of course, we don't know to what extent the Conference on the Future of Europe will be the silver bullet to this issue. Probably will not be a silver bullet. But we know what the problem is. The problem is that the EU is an unfinished project. In a way, it's like, you know, the famous church in Barcelona, the Sagrada Familia, which, you know, they started to build 8 years ago, and they keep building it. So the point is that we have the European Union that policy-wise and actor-wise is a very strange hybrid between a regional organization of cooperation and a federal organization, or something close to a proto-federal state. So if we look, for example, at economy, the EU is very much federal. If we look at foreign policy, if we look at some other areas, it's very much intergovernmental. So the point is that, do we finish the machine? Do we finish the house that we started to build in the early 50s? Of course, there have been different discussions. The previous president of the European Commission came up with different scenarios. One is, again, to move clearly towards progressive federalization of the EU. Other is, let's say, to keep this kind of hybridity and so on. But the key problem is, effectiveness and legitimacy. Now, we know that certain policy areas would work better at the EU level. So if you take, for example, I don't know, foreign affairs, obviously having a common united EU voice would make, again, European interests more protected than having individual member states. The same, for example, works when it comes to, let's say, now health policy, or when it comes again to external trade, or again, when it comes, for example, to fiscal policy. But the point is that in order for the EU to have more and more stronger voice and more competencies on different areas of policies, Europeans need to look at the EU as a legitimate actor. So they need basically to consider that the power that the EU has is legitimate. So we need basically to fill a democratic deficit, a democratic gap, which means that we need to shift more democratic legitimation at the EU level. Now, nowadays, the paradox is that almost 80%, actually, in fact, 85% of all the legislation that affects our daily lives comes from Brussels in one way or another. But most of Europeans think that still the key actors in their daily lives is their national government. Well, in fact, that's not the case. So until the Europeans will not, let's say, we'll see the EU as the main, let's say, decision-making actor when it comes to their lives, and until the EU will not be able to give itself more democratic legitimacy, there will still be this contradiction. And last point before kind of finishing up, we have structures of democratic representation at the EU level. The European Parliament is elected since the 70s. Every citizen of the EU has the right to go to vote for the day of the European elections for citizens to run in the European Parliament. The European Commission and its president have a link of confidence, a vote of confidence by the European Parliament to the European Commission. The problem is that how many Europeans go to vote at the European Parliament elections? Much less than at the national elections. They see the European election as less relevant than the one at the national level. And of course, the member states and the national governments have no joy to become less relevant actors. So the member states still want to play a role. And again, until this contradiction is solved, the EU will face challenges to address especially unprecedented or non-traditional challenges. And yes, probably the Conference on the Future of Europe will propose some solutions, which of course will have to go through treaty change. But again, I really fail to believe that this will be the silver bullet that will provide a solution to every issue.
Thank you very much, Stefano. What a very a great point about how you see about how the EU is actually designed as a democratic institution that is able to navigate through all of these conflicts and differences. So therefore, I would like to now try to contrast it with what's happening with in ASEAN, because I think that there has been sort of a stigma about ASEAN being a little slower, a little, or maybe I think if we quote some other more harsh academia, more dysfunctional, as I quote. So Mbak Citra, how does ASEAN then act in regards of the different interests between all the nation states? Does it really make ASEAN as enabled as some people regard it?
ASEAN survive all the years.
We survive.
The fact is, ASEAN survive. So, 10 of ASEAN members, most of them is middle power. So, I agree with your opinion, Stefanus. It's like a institution, regional organization. It's like a to boost the legitimation about what we act as the state. And as the middle power, they comfort if act through ASEAN to overcome the issue, especially against the external threat. They use regional organization to discuss it. For example, ASEAN facing problem at the South China Seas. It involved Vietnam, Brunei, Philippines, Malaysia, Indonesia against China. So on the South China Sea, ASEAN member use ASEAN to formalize code of conduct, how to behave in South China Sea. And they also close to the US. But at the economic level, they close to China. It's different. It's ambivalence behavior of the ASEAN member state. And then ASEAN member state, they hide behind ASEAN ways, ASEAN norms. Every decision must be full consensus. So they discuss in the ASEAN platform, ASEAN negotiation forum. So as long as we discuss it, so we take our responsibility, because we know that full consensus is very hard to achieve, especially if the conflict is involved in other countries. For example, the haze problem between Indonesia, Singapore, and Malaysia. They discuss in a lot of ASEAN forums, but there's no full consensus about it. And Indonesia always said that you have no interference on our national problem. And the other example is about the Rohingya. The government said that it's our own problem and you should not interfere. So ASEAN cannot go into a whole consensus. And then Indonesia used a bilateral approach to the government, and Indonesia successfully delivered some humanitarian aid, but not solve the problem. That's what I call that ASEAN survive, and ASEAN use as the legitimate tools to overcome the problem. And besides ASEAN, ASEAN member state, they play at the middle power, and then they close into the great power in the region. ASEAN also have strengths. First, sense of community among member is high, mutual trust and confidence among leaders. They always goes to ASEAN events and forum, even though the decision is not full consensus. And external power like the China, US, Australia, India, others know that there's no decision except full consensus. So that's why they always play into the individual state member. For example, China use Myanmar and Cambodia against Vietnam acquisition on the China. So ASEAN cannot came into full consensus. And then for the America, for the United States, is the same behavior. And ASEAN strength is also they develop institution to reinforce the invisible sense of community. And ASEAN still survive because many great powers have a vested interest in keeping ASEAN going. So as long as there is ASEAN, trust to be neutral in the Southeast ASEAN. And but also ASEAN also has a weakness. There's no natural custodian and the absence of strong institution. There's institution, but it's not the strong one. ASEAN Charter in 2008, it holds ASEAN together, but they are not strong enough to provide leadership for ASEAN, like what I have mentioned before. And ASEAN ownership is felt primarily by the government of the region. Sense of belonging in Thailand is different in Indonesia, for example. The other example, Indonesia is always see itself as the natural leaders of ASEAN. But Singapore gained maximalization of benefit of ASEAN. Indonesia makes sure that Southeast Asian region is a peaceful region. But who gained the benefit most? Singapore, Thailand, but not Indonesia. That's why the Jokowi at the first time presidency, he questioned Indonesian role in ASEAN. It costs Indonesian a lot, but Indonesia has less benefit than Singapore or Thailand. And I add that ASEAN threat is still geopolitical rivalries, and political leaders are focused on domestic challenge rather than regional concern. That's a threat for ASEAN. But opportunity for ASEAN, growing multilateralism at the global level, and the general rise of ASEAN in world affairs. So everybody will look in ASEAN and make sure ASEAN and Southeast ASEAN is a peaceful region. That's all, Demas.
Okay, thank you very much, Mbak Citra. And after we, I think that after the first two sessions, we already discussed about what is the nature of regional integration in each region, and then like how they are very different, and then they have both strengths and weaknesses in each of themselves. I would like to try to explore some of the issues that are affecting the regional dynamics in both region. And I would like to focus specifically on a few issues that both ASEAN and AU have both have similarity in itself. So one of the issues that I think has been mentioned a few times specifically is about the great power dynamics in the region. And both of EU and ASEAN is similar because in each region, they are neighboring with a great power, a bigger power than perhaps most of its member states. In the case of EU, it is Russia. And in the case of ASEAN, it is China. So first of all, I would like to ask to Stefano, how does the presence of Russia actually affect the position of EU specifically, not only in its foreign policy, but also does it affect its domestic policy in the region?
Well, that's a very relevant question. I mean, of course, like, I would first of like to respond, like, you know, how does the presence of Russia, well, you know, sadly or luckily, we cannot change geography. So in fact, Russia is there, and you know, there is nothing that we can do in terms of, you know, making it further. Now, in terms of how Russia has played a role on the process of integration, I would mention two things. The first one is in the long term. When Russia didn't exist yet, and in fact, instead of Russia, there was a much larger country called Soviet Union, in fact, of which, let's say, illegally annexed, also Estonia was part. Well, in fact, one of the key determinant for the start of the process of regional integration in Western Europe was in fact the Cold War, something that Cider has also mentioned in the context of Southeast Asia. So clearly the first steps in the direction of regional integration in Europe were very functional to the context of the Cold War, were very much supported by the US, which saw that as part of a broader transatlantic community. And in fact, it's not a case that relations between the European communities and the Soviet Union were basically inexistent until the very late 80s, when in fact the Soviet Union needed money, basically. So the main reason for formalizing the relation between the two actors were economic and were, of course, needs of trade from the Soviet side with the West. What we have seen, on the other hand, was a very active role of the Soviet Union politically, both within the member states. The local communist parties were seen as, let's say, a factor of influence in domestic politics, but also somehow, at least until the Prague Spring, a kind of informal boycott but from the side of the Western communist parties when it comes to the process of integration. Only after the Prague Spring, and in fact, an increasing distance from Moscow, we saw that the communist parties start to play a constructive role in terms of European integration with, in fact, the emergence of what is generally referred to as Eurocommunism. Now, if we take the time machine, we come back to our times. I mean, Russia, yes, clearly represents a geopolitical challenge to the EU. Again, represents a geopolitical challenge to the stability of the region. We have seen, again, the case of Ukraine. We have seen the case of Georgia. We have seen the case of Moldova, and more and more. So clearly, Russia is not playing by the agreed rules of the Western European community and does not accept those rules. Now, of course, we can dig deep and discuss what are the reasons of that. Some say that Russia's goodwill in the 90s was betrayed by the West that didn't understand the specificity of Russia. Others would say that Russia is an empire, has always been an empire, has always had this imperial attitude, and it doesn't go away from the DNA. So there is no way in which Russia can behave non-imperially. So there are many ways to look at this, and is not this the context to dig deep into that. And I've already discussed again what is the context of EU-Russia relations. The EU has been trying for a long time to frame the relation with Russia in terms of agreed norms and rules. There is a partnership and cooperation agreement which has been designed, in fact, by the two parties, which has defined the way in which the cooperation should take place. And four spaces of cooperation in security, economics, science, and so on and so forth, in order to deepen the cooperation. Now, of course, Russia not playing by the agreed rules has made those spaces of cooperation redundant. And we know that, again, starting from the invasion of Eastern Ukraine and the occupation of Crimea, in fact, there is fairly little to do, and all these fora are now completely ineffective. The PCA has been frozen, and the spaces of cooperation have been frozen. Russia has been kicked down by the G7, from the G8, which became G7, and so on. But this is one part of the story. The other part of the story, which relates to your question, is how is Russia playing a game in within the EU? So we know that, again, there are certain political actors inside the member states that are fairly, let's say, responsive to the Kremlin's narrative. There are political forces on the fringe which are becoming increasingly central, that are fairly close in terms of values, in terms of perception, in terms of understanding of internal politics and geopolitics to the Kremlin's narrative. Again, we have Marine Le Pen in France, we have the League in Italy, we have Alternative für Deutschland in Germany. And again, we also have governments that are fairly close to a common understanding of an illiberal way of doing things. Look at Hungary, for example. So here we see that Russia is trying to play in this divide and rule within the member states. And of course, the overall challenges to illiberal democracies globally, not only at the EU level, I would say that very much are conducive to this kind of game. And I would say that we see like two waves of mutual effect, influence. We see this type of influence from Russia to the EU member states, the one that I just mentioned, but then we also see on the other hand, that the EU tried in the early 90s, mid 90s, to again, Europeanize Russia. There have been also a way of mutual influence from the EU to Russia, which has been fairly effective in the early 90s, but which has gone really to a crash, I would say, in the late 90s, in which, let's say, Russia has faced, a very relevant economic crisis, which has undermined the trust in, again, liberal democracy, Western-minded reforms, and have somehow paved the way to what we have seen as a growing autocratization of Russian politics, in which somehow civil peace, a certain degree of quietness at the national level is guaranteed by, taking away more and more spaces of, liberal politics in the country. So in a way, there is kind of informal social contract according to which you are willing to pay a price in terms of democracy and in terms of erosion of rights in order to get some sort of stability. And that, again, what we have been witnessing in Russia starting from the beginning of 2000, at least.
Okay, thank you very much, Stefano, for the elaboration. Now, I would like to ask to Chitra on whether China has the same position and agenda in the case of ASEAN.
China. Okay. ASEAN. Before China rise, the high influence by the US and Japan, what I said before, that ASEAN integration is influenced by MNC from the US and the FDI from the Japan. And China now, the biggest partner, trade partner for ASEAN. And in Indonesia, China is the second partner after the US and the second big investor after the US also. And China also have cooperation partnership with Singapore, comprehensive strategic cooperation partnership with Laos, Myanmar, Cambodia, Vietnam, Thailand, comprehensive strategic partnership with Malaysia, Indonesia, and with ASEAN. China also has a free trade agreement with ASEAN, China-ASEAN free trade agreement in 2010. Whether China a threat or opportunity, your question, it depends on the state member. If we talk about the Thailand more having more benefit compared to Indonesia during the China-ASEAN free trade area. At the China-ASEAN free trade area, there is a mechanism like early harvest system for the agricultural products, and Thailand gains benefit for the early harvest system and successfully market their agricultural product to China. But Indonesia is not so benefited with China-ASEAN free trade area. Indonesia economy more than 95% based on small and medium enterprises. During the free trade, more and more Chinese products, the bulk products, cheap and bulk, has changed small and medium enterprises from the producer into distributor. And Indonesia is not getting more benefit from the China-ASEAN free trade area. And also, the elite in Indonesia, like what Stefano have said, they have people in the internal government. Russia has people in the internal government. In the Indonesian elite, army, veteran army, they usually hate China because we have the historical context that China involved in communist rebellion in 1965 in Indonesia. And Chinese government said that every Chinese diaspora is Chinese citizen, even though they gain citizen from the host country. So dual citizenship is bring super hit into the most Indonesian elite. And in 1997, during the ASEAN financial crisis, Indonesia suffered much to the crisis, and they blame Chinese descendant, Chinese Indonesian, as the actor who put Indonesia into crisis because they are a rich people and gain benefit from Indonesia economy, elite at the Indonesia economy. That's why in the Jakarta in 1997, there's a huge riot and Chinese descendant raped by Indonesian. And also in other area in Indonesia, in Surabaya also. During that time, I still remember because I'm also Chinese descendant, unfortunately. And in the situation in 1997 and 1998 is not fortunate for the Chinese descendant. And there's also limitation, and most of the Chinese descendants go out from Indonesia, including their investment. So at the history like that, in Indonesia especially, we always suspicious with China because we don't trust China for the political riot and then economic unfortunate to Indonesia in 1997. And it is worsened by the presidential election and the using of the politics of identity in Indonesian election. So Jokowi administration seen China, treat China with hati-hati itu apa ya?
Careful.
Yeah, careful approach with careful approach and at this there's a different feeling with China. Jokowi close to China because China now is quote per quote the only nation who have money after 2008. Global crisis, North American is no longer have enough money, and the most Western traditional donor is run out of money, and then global institution is also run out of money. So G7 goes to G20, and China is like the only hope that have a lot of money for the aid, for the investment, and for the infrastructure project for the Jokowi administration. But Jokowi has to be careful to the elites, especially from army veteran that's still suspicious with China. So during the BRI forum 1 and 2, Jokowi has put certain area that Chinese investment could invest in that only area. That's how how Asian, Southeast Asian nations see China. And the second problem is China aggressively behave in South China Sea is not give satisfaction with the other countries. It's like a territorial dispute with Vietnam, Spratly Island, and Paracel Island, with Malaysia, 12 Island, Brunei, on Louisa Reef, and then Philippines on Spratly, and at Natuna, Indonesia, and with Indonesia in Natuna. So China aggressive behavior has put Asian countries go to the US, like what I said previously. For the South China Sea, South Asian countries use ASEAN and close relation with the US. But for the investment, they close to China and they try to attract another investor, and they usually play the situation to attract Japan. Japan historically has built major infrastructure in Southeast Asia nation. And then Japan feel threatened that their position replaced by China with BRI. And the Southeast Asian nation put this situation to benefit themselves. So they try to close with Japan, and they also close with China to get more funding to their project. That's all.
Okay, thank you very much, Mbak Citra and Stefano. There is actually still some other convergent issues that both European Union and ASEAN yet to face. For example, the crisis of financial a crisis in 1998 and 2008 for EU, and the COVID-19 issues, for example. However, due to time constraint, we cannot try to discuss them one by one. But I think for the conclusion session, I would like to sort of try to take an extraction from all of them, and I would like to ask a very important question about the future of regional integration in EU and ASEAN, because again, both regional institutions have come through a lot of things. They have come through a lot of crisis in many sectors. And my question is, does this crisis, does these challenges that is faced by both organizations are making the regional integration in each region stronger, or does it make them more fragile? I think I can give first to Stefano.
Yeah, I'll try to be brief. I mean, as I think we've already discussed so far, I believe that, you know, the bigger the challenges, the more rational it makes sense to invest in regional integration. I mean, in a way, like, it's a quite easy principle to understand. I believe that, in fact, if a number of countries face common challenges, it's obviously more effective for them to stick together and to try somehow to address and tackle these challenges together. Obviously, we have also explored what are the limits of that. Because of course, let's say, provided that we want to address the same challenges, we also should have the same goals and the same objectives. And here, of course, comes to the table the issue of national interests. So, I mean, of course, we have issues related to decision-making. How do we, let's say, how do we basically combine, how do we kind of harmonize different policy interests and national interests? And also, how do we bring to, again, new areas of regional integration, the necessary legitimacy? And this, I think, especially in democratic societies, I think it's fundamental to address this, which means that how do we convince citizens of the EU, that in fact the EU is the best platform to address these areas and the most legitimized and legitimate one. In order to do that, again, we need to create more effective structure of democratic representation at the EU level. There have been proposals, there have been steps in that direction. But I would just conclude by saying that if we do not manage to combine these three dimensions, effectiveness, blended sovereignty, and the necessary legitimacy, democratic legitimacy, we will never succeed to get, again, properly and effectively finishing this house that was started in the 50s. So this, I think, is fundamental. And if you want to keep an eye on some aspects in terms of regional integration over the next maybe decade at the EU level, this is where I would recommend you to keep an eye.
Okay, thank you very much, Stefano. And Mbak Citra, maybe your conclusion towards this discussion and the question.
I will criticize about the ASEAN community itself. There's economic, politics, and social, cultural. Like what I said before, the crisis is strengthened the ASEAN itself because all the nation have benefited with the peaceful condition at the region. But my first critique on the ASEAN economy, it only protects end user as the customer, and then disregard existing bilateral economic agreement. And there's no mechanism on detail on how the region acts as a whole. It's different AU. And then at the social cultural, there's still conflicting interests with commercial and between commercial or industrial interests. And then participation should not be limited to this sphere and diversity and identity of people within member states. It's still questioned who identity is ASEAN identity. Political principle, non-interference, consensus, national and regional resilience, respect for sovereignty, maybe ASEAN should reconsider about these norms, about this principle, and put another forum and event to discuss. So we need more legal binding agreement to make ASEAN work, and in order to limit the non-interference, consensus, and respect for sovereignty, we need more event and forum for them. And ASEAN should involve more non-state actors into their dialogue and event, because it's still state-centric dialogue, state-centric forum, state-centric event, and ASEAN need to make non-state actors involved in their decision. So, citizens of ASEAN will feel the same identity as ASEAN, as not only ASEAN put at the government level, how the government of each country feels about the ASEAN. It will not benefit all the citizens of ASEAN. That's all, Demas.
Thank you very much, Mbak Citra. And last but not least, I would like to pass my gratitude on behalf of Cakra Studi Global Strategies and Universitas Erlangga to Stefano and Mbak Citra for being able to share their insights with us on our discussion today. I think that at the end of our discussion, we are able to sort of create a cross-region understanding about European Union and ASEAN, about how they are quite different in nature about the regional integration. And although they have similar issues to be faced, they have sort of different responses, and it's in regards about the political, economical, and social background that sort of underline become the underlying factor behind their integration. I think I would also like to pass our gratitude to Ibu Dr. Phil Siti Rahmawati Susanto, Head of Department of International Relations, Universitas Erlangga, for being here, for being present today. Ibu Siti, is there any words that you would like to convey? Or maybe we also would like to pass our gratitude to Olga Bogdanova as the Deputy Head of Academic Affairs of Johan Schut Institute. And of course, we all also would like to pass our gratitude to all the participants, but there is 50 participants that join our discussion today. Thank you very much, all of the speakers and participants and all the committee that made our discussion today possible. We still have a lot of future programs to be, a dissemination program to be discussed in Cakra Studi Global Strategies, and hopefully we will be able to discuss a lot more about contemporary issues and a lot more. So thank you very much. I would like to apologize should there be any mistakes on my behalf. Thank you very much, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. And before we close, maybe I think we can take a picture together before we close this session. Maybe I would like to invite everyone to open their camera. Maybe other participants would like to open their camera to join our photo session. We'll give maybe a few seconds to
thank you, Stefano and Bacitra. Thank you so much.
Thanks to you for this very kind invitation.
For Anggi or anyone who take the picture.
Thank you for having me, Raditya.
Okay, now that we're done with the very wonderful discussion, we invite all the participants to turn on their camera. There's two people admitting to the room. Okay, let's just go ahead and take the picture. In the count of three, I'm going to take a screenshot. So let's prepare ourselves. Let's fix our hairs and stuff. And yeah, on the count of three, one, two, three. Let's do another one, another pose. 1, 2, 3. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Stefano, Mbak Citra. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye. Bye. Have a nice continuation of the day. Bye.
Bye. Thank you, everyone.
Anggi, you can end the meeting.